Turn with me to the book of Mark, chapter 5. We will begin at verse 25. Mark chapter 5, beginning at verse 25. Am I coming through okay?
Amen.
We've got to work with this hell night. It's a jailbreak. I need to be free.
Yeah.
Amen. Bless the Lord.
Amen.
You don't tell me what's going to happen tomorrow. Mark chapter 5, beginning with verse 25, and as our custom here, if God has given you the power and the strength to stand, we ask that you would, in honor of his word.
Amen.
Mark chapter 5, beginning in verse 25, reading out of the King James today.
Amen.
And a certain woman which had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was nothing better, but rather grew worse, when she had heard of Jesus. Y'all just missed the opportunity. I'm sorry. When she had heard of Jesus, she came in the press behind and touched his garment. For she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, who touched my clothes? And his disciples, who had no earthly idea of what he was talking about, nor could they at this time, simply because they had not come into the room. Oh, that's not okay, let me get back. And his disciples said unto him, thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, who touched me? And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him, and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, daughter, thy faith.
Yes, sir.
Daughter.
Uh-huh.
Thy faith.
Right.
Has made thee whole.
Yes.
Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. Just want to talk to you today from the topic, faith that pulls on God's favor.
Yes.
Faith that pulls on God's favor. Father, in me now, reveal thy glory. Let thy might be unshown. Keep me from the world's defilement, save me for thyself alone. Psalm 45, let my tongue be the pen of a ready writer. Let what you've placed in my heart flow through my lips, that it might write upon the tables of the hearts of those that shall hear it. We believe it.
We believe it.
We receive it.
We receive it.
We expect it.
We expect it.
We claim it.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Turn to your neighbor. Look that neighbor right in the eye. Say, neighbor.
This word
is for me.
By this word,
I am saved.
By this word,
I am healed.
By this word,
I am delivered.
By his word,
I am set free.
Neighbor,
oh
neighbor,
you might be helped,
but
this word
is for me.
You can be seated in the Lord's presence. Faith that pulls on God's faith. Over the course of 2018, God really wants us to capitalize and maximize on the opportunity of his favor. For God does not give his favor simply because he has nothing else to do, but God gives his favor to be able to allow for us the opportunity to walk through doors to make a blessing. God's favor is simply the keys that will unlock the doors to the garage that has your Bentley in it. It is God's favor is the keys that would unlock the doors. Turn me down on this reverb because I'm getting a little bit back in the monitors. Turn them down. Just up, right there on number two. You know what? Thank you, Lord. I solved all that problem. All right. There we go. Bless the Lord. All right. God's favor, God's honor. That's gonna hold me down. I need to move. I appreciate it. That's gonna hold me down. God's favor is such that it allows us the opportunity to be able to walk into blessings that we would never imagine. But in order for us to understand that, there are some things we need to look at. First of all, capitalize. To gain by turning something to an advantage. God's favor. He wants us to take his favor and use it to our advantage. And I see now for some of y'all, God has lost after y'all right there. Because you all feel that it is not a fair advantage to use God's favor. But let me tell you. Whenever God is on our side, it ain't never failing. I mean, it ain't never a disadvantage. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And I'm just going to tell you, me and God together makes me the majority. Maximizing, to increase something to its fullest capacity. God wants us to maximize his favor. He wants us to take his favor and just push it to its maximum capacity. Now here's a little secret, don't tell nobody. I don't care how hard you try, you will never be able to maximize God's favor.
All right.
Pastor Bebo, what you saying? I'm just saying, just go ahead and ride the wave. Because it ain't going to never run out. God's favor, God's friendly regard shown towards us for the approving consideration or attention, especially in, get this, seemingly unfair way. God looks at our life and he sees that we're at a disadvantage. So now he doesn't give us his favor to level the playing field.
All right.
He gives us his favor so now we have the advantage.
All right. Amen.
We don't serve a God who plays from behind or deals in deficit.
Yeah.
Even at halftime, God is never behind.
All right.
Well, okay, I know we got folks with you, but come on now. Y'all making me work too hard. Faith that pulls on God's favor. Consultation for a cure of calamity. When we look at verses 25 through 26, we see here there's a perplexity of problems, and that happens when man has reached his limitation. I'm just talking about maximizing and capitalizing on God's favor.
Yes,
anytime man has reached his limitation,
yes.
That's an avenue. That's a call to God. I need your favor.
Right.
Man has done all he can do. Lord, if I've never needed you before, I sure do need you now.
Yes.
I'm in the text. By a show of hand, who believe the word of God is true? I'm just going to teach. One of the things we see here is that she had an issue. Deacon Riffro, she had issues. But in order for us to truly grasp the meaning of the content and context of the scripture, we need to get a definition of what issues are. The action of going, coming, or flowing out, egress, or emergence. A final outcome that usually constitutes a solution as a problem or resolution as other difficulties. A final conclusion or decision about something arrived at after consideration. something that people are talking about, thinking about, etc. And then I had to, for this last one, I had to go to the Urban Dictionary. Because that's the one that we really embrace. A fancy and elegant way to say, you got a problem. Come on, baby. You got issues. You got issues. That's what we said. You got a problem. She had problems. She had issues. She had issues. And the truth of it is, as long as we keep saying good morning, there's going to come a time in our life we're going to have some issues. We're going to have some problems. I've had a problem for the last couple of days. The weather has been nice for golf. And I had some issues. Thank you. I got one of them. And I had a problem. I couldn't go. I had some issues. My hand was trembling because I couldn't put the golf club, but I had some issues. I had some issues. But see, I understand that you all find that humorous because you've never had a problem or issue in your life. Most of you are just seeing me as a comedian today because your life is just filled with nothing but God's blessing and bliss. You've never experienced confusion, chaos, or clutter ever in your life. You've never had anything that has caused you discomfort, disruption, distortion, or even to be displeased. To you, an issue is something that you pick up at the grocery store when you're getting ready to check out. But I got some issues. Okay, let me put it this way. Three types of issues. Type one. That component of a or your character that is screwed up due to a previous relationship.
Because we're going to be in a relationship with some screwed up folks. And why they screwed up? Because they got
None of these two apply to you. But it has this third one. The third issue. What your current relationship has when your type 1 issue gets in the way of their attempt to give you the type 2 issue. All right, let's go back.
Okay.
Type 1 is the component of your character that is screwed up due to a past relationship.
All right.
Type 2 is being screwed up due to your current relationship. Type 3 is when your relationship now, your current relationship,
yeah,
okay, is when your past issue is getting in the way of your current relationship giving you an issue.
Yes.
That's awesome. Okay.
Okay, let me, yeah, I got to unpack that. Basically what it is, your current relationship wants to screw you up, but it's not successful because we still suffering from our past relationship that has us screwed up. We can't get screwed up by the present because we still screwed up by the past. Thank you, Dean. Thank you. But see, I understand that none of y'all screwed up. Here we go. Let's get into the lesson because we got some folks we got to go home. Calamity, an event that causes great harm and suffering or misfortune. Let's look at it. There was a certain woman, and here's the thing that I love about God's word, is that whenever the person is named, that gives us license and authorization to put ourselves right there. So there was a certain person, me, that had issues. Now watch the calamity. The time period, 12 years. Some of us can't handle going through nothing 12 minutes. 12 years. You want to talk about letting patience have its perfect work? Lord, when can this thing be over? She was dealing with this calamity 12 years. If she never needed for her faith to pull on God's faith, not only was there the time period, you had the treatment process. She had suffered many things of many physicians. She was a medical guinea pig.
Right.
Trying this, trying that. And then she would spend all the money she had. Some of us go through some things and we other folks as guinea pigs. Well, if I was you, I would do this. And the truth of the matter is, forget them being us, they ain't gonna do it being them. So they're gonna suggest to you to do something that they wouldn't do, so they can see the outcome to see if they're gonna do it. Because if it works for you, then I do it. But if it don't work for you, hey. Some of us spend time, money, and effort trying to be friends with folk that ain't worth a dime. Just to try to heal a calamity that we had. But then you have the trauma that's progressive. It didn't get better, it got worse. Over 12 years, she was taking this and that and advice from this person and that person, and instead of getting better, it's getting worse. There are times we go through life and we in some calamities and we doing all that we can, and it doesn't seem like it's getting better, it's getting worse. But here's the thing, I just stopped by to let you know, that's just God setting you up for your faith to be able to pull on his face. Because keep in mind, it doesn't happen until man has reached his limitations. Man may practice medicine, but God perfects it. If it wasn't for God, it wouldn't let him work.
Amen.
I don't care how many Advils, Motrin, etc. that you take. If God didn't want it to work, we'd still have headaches.
That's right.
Yes, yes.
Cultivation of the cure over calamity. Courage to conquer from the word. If you look at verses 27 through 29, there's a nice little series or patterns of things that happens to get us to this place to where we can, our faith can pull on God's favor. It says, and she heard of Jesus. Then we're from, can I just do Bible study right
here?
The text says she heard, which means previous to this, she didn't know it.
All right, yes, yes, yes. Wow. All right.
Faith comes by hearing.
Yes.
And hearing by the word of God.
Yes, yes, yes.
She heard about the word. In the midst of her calamity, she was chasing what she thought was the cure. But it wasn't until she heard about the real cure. I heard about a man called Jesus. We talked last week about my girl. From behind to touch him. Now what? Now what? This is what makes this so awesome. And this is where her faith really kicked in. During this time, with the type of issues that she was dealing with, she was ostracized.
Yes.
She was thought to be unclean. She wasn't dealing with prejudice. She was dealing with principle.
Yes, yes.
Because the law says that during this time, women are unclean. And not only are you unclean, but anything you touch or touches you becomes unclean.
Yes.
So now she's having to deal with this by herself.
Yes.
For 12 years, even those who may have wanted to help her, they're not, because if I look to help them, now I'm going to become unclean and I'm going to be ostracized.
Yes, yes.
Even though you saved and I saved, I don't want to deal with your problem because, would you just touch it and agree with me? Well, I don't agree with you, but I don't know if I can touch you.
All right.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. I was talking about church for a bit. Okay. Because your issue is too dirty for me to handle.
All right.
My issue not as dirty as yours. See, my issue is dusty.
Right.
Your issue is muddy.
Yeah.
See, my issue, I can just take a towel and just wipe it away. But yours, we gotta go get a scrub brush. I'm just saying, so we can see how. So now, because there's a multitude of people around Jesus, and anything that comes in contact with her now becomes unclean or defiled. Mm-hmm. But at the risk of being stoned for the premeditation and intentionality of contaminating other people. When we sling it, the scripture, I press towards the mark of the high calling. No, there's a prize.
Yeah.
A prize was deliverance.
Hello, I'm Pastor Demo Moffitt of the Orange Church of God, 1911 North 16th Street. And I want to take this time to extend a personal invitation to you to join us on Sunday mornings at 10 a.m. and Tuesday night at 7 p.m. for a dynamic and enriching service. Remember this, we are a real church for real people.